Facebook's really the big kahuna of network effects, and that makes them incredibly defensible. I think there's some temporary talk about the policies of Facebook, but I think what's important in order to see clearly is to really look at the mechanics underlying what makes Facebook Facebook. So in 2004, Mark Zuckerberg wakes up with a personal direct network effect with real identities.
Harvard didn't have a Facebook, so that's the gap that we were trying to fill.
It is a very powerful form of network effects. But he immediately realized that he needed to add other defensibilities. He then, as he expanded into other colleges, created a real bandwagon effect. Each new college wanted Facebook to come to it, and no one wanted to be left out.
And, like, you know, this is pretty cool. Like, I bet this would work at other schools.
And once that was rolling, he started to scale up the business until in 2005, there were a series of big articles about him in the Wall Street Journal, New York Times, sort of establishing the brand of Facebook and the fact that it was a phenomenon. He could then go back and scale up even more, including leaving just colleges and starting to take on the whole world. They saw the opportunity to create an embedding strategy, create software to allow Facebook users to log in to other websites using their Facebook login. So hundreds of thousands of websites have now adopted this Facebook login, and Facebook is now embedded in the whole ecosystem of the entire web. It allows them to have an embedding strategy, which is very defensible. Once they'd established several defensibilities, including the personal direct network effect, they were free to explore other network effects. I think Mark in 2007 actually said something like, I think that network effects shouldn't be underestimated with what we do. In 2007, they were able to launch a two-sided platform network effect, very much like a Microsoft. So they opened up Facebook platform.
By the next morning, we had so much traffic. They were literally driving around the San Francisco Bay with a U-Haul truck, begging and asking people for servers to handle all the growth.
And that allowed entrepreneurs to build code that would run on top of Facebook, making Facebook even more sticky and providing more things for their users to do on Facebook. Ultimately, I think after 8 years, the activity there is quite low, but it was still a really good idea, and they might return to that idea over time. Then they started working on a two-sided marketplace effect, which with the media companies that were advertising on them. They built out wonderful self-serve advertising tools, much as Google and Craigslist had done before them, but accessing such an active and large audience.
Your customers are on Facebook every day. The world has gone social. Be part of the conversation.
23 or 24% of all the ad revenue spent online comes through Facebook. But with all the traffic that they had, they started developing a data network effect, impacting Facebook in three ways. One, they've got so much content that they can choose better content to show to me. The second thing is that the number of human engagements they have with the content, the likes, the shares, the comments, these things actually add value because of that data that I'm getting. And the third thing they have on the data side is the real-time data of all the activity on the site allows them to adjust and update the value of my feed in real time, much like Waze will do. So in 2011, they launched Facebook Messenger, which actually has utility, and it's often about getting things done. And then in 2014, they saw WhatsApp. And WhatsApp was this personal utility direct network effect.
It says it has 450 million monthly active users.
Even just independently, I think it's quite a good bet.
And they resolved that they would pay whatever it took.
Facebook will pay $19 billion in cash and stock.
And it also made them double down on Facebook Messenger by hiring in whoever it took to make that the best product it could be and to grow it from 100 million to over a 1.5 billion today. And so between 2011 and 2014, you can see them really doubling down on the network effects and being very smart about not letting somebody else with a network effect get past them. So in their continued pursuit of network effects, in 2016, Facebook relaunches Marketplace. They had tried classifieds in the past several times and it hadn't taken, but this time it seems to be working. And they reported over 500 million users last year. And so this is going into the area that Craigslist has owned for years. They've been impenetrable, but perhaps Facebook, with their real identity and the frequency of use they have, might be able to pry that market open. So this makes Facebook the big kahuna of network effects. They've understood it all these years. They've built products that are excellent at developing their network effects. This company is not going anywhere. Are there threats to the company? Sure, of course, there always are. The major one that we see right now is literally just government action. So if there is a threat to Facebook, we see it coming possibly from three directions. Now, the first would be if Facebook becomes a public health concern in the same way that tobacco is, because of addiction and depression and anxiety. There's also a privacy issue, obviously, with Facebook. You know, with the GDPR in Europe, you could see that taking effect in Europe and then bleeding over into the US. And then the third direction could come from the antitrust direction. With Facebook being so dominant, you could see the Department of Justice stepping in, potentially asking Facebook to divest itself of Instagram and WhatsApp. But beyond that, it's hard to see because it's hard to break up these interconnected software products. If there is another threat, there's negative network effects. There's so many people there that it pollutes the experience or keeps it from being cool, like when older relatives join Facebook and start commenting on your photos. We've already seen that a lot of teens don't use Facebook, but I think with good product design, it's a solvable problem. As a media company, Facebook is very unique because they have a many-to-many direct network effect. All the media companies that came before, like television, radio, magazines, these were one-to-many network effects, two-sided marketplace, if you will, not nearly as strong. If you see clearly what the mechanics of what Facebook has done and you see past the noise, you can see that Facebook is as strong as ever and getting stronger.